another data set from you and other and his colleagues that is available in the BITC webpage. And you can see the difference in terms of the number of stations that each one of these two data sets used for building these surfaces. If we have here 47,000 and here we have here only less than half of that, it's clear that this information is richer, it's more reliable. So it's very important, as Lucian mentioned to you, that you read the information associated to each one of your environmental data, which are called metadata, to know how they produced this information. The other way of producing raster data is by remote sensing, by capturing from satellites. The sensors are mounted in satellites or other aircraft, and they take images of the surface of the Earth in different parts of this, which is called the electromagnetic spectrum, or in different parts of the light. For you to have an idea, here is a portion of the electromagnetic spectrum that our eyes can see. This is the visible portion of the electromagnetic spectrum. But sensors in satellites can capture information in different portions far beyond our eyes can see. So if we can capture information, for example, here in the infrared section of the spectrum, we can literally see aspects of the surface of the Earth that we cannot see with our eyes. So, with these properties of the remote sensing data, we have been able to produce environmental layers that can be very useful. This is an example. These are letters, leaves, observed under different parts of the spectrum, electromagnetic spectrum. This is the natural view. This is in the infrared part of the spectrum. And this is in the far infrared. So you can see here that you can delimitate very well the beams of the letters of the leaves. So we can capture different elements with the satellites, and when we combine this information, the bands that are called remote sensing, each band refers to each portion of the spectrum that you are capturing with the satellite. When we combine these bands, we can produce some information that can be very useful for our purposes of modeling the niches of the species. For example, these vegetation indices. These refer to combinations of bands that give us information about the condition of the vegetation, the health of the vegetation, the people, and chlorophyll content or water content. We have used this information for building niche models with very, very, very interesting results. So, remote sensing matter, it's a very rich source of data for creating these environmental layers for our purposes. For example, here, you can track the phenology of the vegetation in a region when you analyze a time series of vegetation indices in that region. You can see the time period when the vegetation is peak of the greenness, or when it's becoming yellow, etc. There are hundreds of satellites around the Earth with thousands of sensors and the possibilities of use that information for models. But satellite information has other type of limitations. It's an instantaneous view of the surface of the Earth. Each one of the images is specifically in one time, in one place. If you try to use this information for modeling the historic distribution of species, you are violating the principle that the biological data has to match the timing of the environmental data. So the uses of remote sensing data has to be very careful for specific questions regarding the dynamics of the distribution of the species. This is one of an example of one of these products that you can find and you can download for free for the whole world from this satellite. This sensor is called MODIS, and you can see here the list of products that offers this satellite for the land and for the ocean. So here you can find, for example, evapotranspiration, which could be a very useful layer in niche modeling for some species, or net primary productivity could also be very, very informative. Another set of very, very useful information derived from remote sensors is from radar sensors is the topography of the surface of the Earth. The topography includes the altitude, but also the slope, the inclination of the mountains, or the terrain, the facing of these slopes, which is called aspect, and all the derivatives from the topography of the surface of the Earth. So combining these products of topography with climate is the most common combination of environmental layers for running models at large scales, and when the purpose is to describe like historic distributions or something that is not very dynamic. Something that you have to pay attention to is not only that the data exists, or in some other instances, you have several data sets available for you, and you need to decide which one. They provide the same information. For example, you have maps for the mean annual temperature for all the world. You have several options, several data sets that present this specific variable at the same resolution, maybe. How can you decide which one is better for you? Well, you need to go to the metadata and see how they develop each one of these data sets. This is an example from Mexico in which we compare this map of the annual temperature of Mexico from the working database and from a database that was produced by one of my colleagues in Mexico, specifically for Mexico. This is for the whole world. Sorry. This is for the whole world. This is specifically for Mexico. But they have the same information. It's at the same spatial resolution. So we always said, well, which one is better? Well, we do a comparison of these two, and this is the map that shows the differences between these two. And you
can see that we have areas in Mexico that can be 10 Celsius degrees different from one to the other. It's a lot. So one of those maps is wrong. Well, we know the way my colleague built this map and the way Robert Hickman's built this other map. And my colleague spent several months cleaning up the climate data from the climate stations. Whereas Robert used a world database that is available without many cleaning effort. So this is, in the case of Mexico, this is much more reliable. But it's because we know how each one of them built this information. Another aspect that we need to consider is the spatial resolution of information. Spatial resolution refers to the size of the pixels. Here, you have here Madagascar at two different resolutions. This is a much finer resolution than this one. But a finer resolution doesn't mean that the information is better. It looks better, and for some analysis, it's much better to have very fine resolutions if our species is moving in a very small range, for example. But sometimes downscaling the maps to final resolutions make distortions of the original data that are unacceptable. So don't think that the final the resolution you find it's better. That's not true. You need to read the metadata and see if this information is reliable or not. But this has an effect, an important effect in terms of our niche modeling exercises. We just commented on the spatial correlation of the points. The larger we use the pixel size, we will reduce our sample of occurrence data, because in each one of the pixels you will enclose more and more points. So it's important always to think and balance the benefits of using fine or coarse resolution. If you're doing a continental analysis, for example, for the whole Africa, going too fine maybe is not worth it for your purposes. We talk about temporal resolution. This means what is the time span that your environmental data has, and it depends on the question you are using. When you are doing analysis on different temporal scenarios or climate change, for example, for the future or for the past, you need to use exactly the same set of variables that you are using in the calibration scenario. Normally, the calibration scenario is the present, and the other scenario would be, for example, the future. Well, you need to use exactly the same number and type of variables in the two scenarios in order to make a model. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to run a model. It's important to highlight that this whole thing of doing models for future scenarios in the studies of climate change has become a fashion also in the world. And people don't stop and think on what they are doing when you are projecting your models to 2020, 2050, and 2080. It's very important that you know the reliability of those projections to the future. The further you go from the present scenario, uncertainty of those climates increase exponentially. The same thing applies for past scenarios. The farther you go from the present, uncertainty becomes larger and larger and larger. And to my view, most of the studies on climate change based exclusively on projections are highly unbelievable because of the uncertainty associated to the scenarios. So pay attention and be careful when using future scenarios or past scenarios. Well, in sum, this is the last one. It's very important that you think carefully on the variables that you will use in your modeling exercises. Don't simply be a mechanical user of this information. Think carefully on your species, on the ecology of your species, on the ecology of, on the biology of your species, and based on that, knowledge, decide what information you need to use. Do you have any questions?